hate is a much stronger word in our language. But in their language, it was mean, it often meant to just, to not prefer something. Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. Just means I have preferred Jacob over Esau. When it says that Jacob's two wives, Rachel and Leah, it says he loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. Then the next verse says, when God saw that that Leah was hated, he opened her womb. Well, was she hated? It says he loved Rachel more than he loved Leah. In fact, even in the passage in Luke 14, where Jesus says you have to hate your father, mother, wife, and children, the parallel in Matthew 10 says, anyone who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who loves wife or children more than me is not worthy. To say you hate something means that you place something else above it. You prefer something else before it. And Jesus is saying, if you love your life in this world, that is, if you place nothing ahead of your life, if you don't place the interest of the kingdom of God ahead of your own life, then you'll lose your life anyway. What's the point of trying to save your life anyway? In another place, at Caesarea Philippi, Jesus had said this, if anyone come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. Whoever will seek to save his life will lose it, he said. But whoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Same saying in a different setting and a different slight wording. But the idea is, you seek to save your life, what point is there in that? You're going to lose it. It's just get used to it. You're going to die. So staying alive is, if you make that your chief priority, it's a fool's errand. You can't do it forever. You're going to lose it anyway. So make something else your priority. If you hate your life, that is, if you give it a lower priority, if you prefer God's will for your life, if you prefer God's kingdom to your life, you thus hate your life, so to speak. Then it's like being willing to be a seed that falls into the ground and dies. But you'll become fruitful. There are many people who produce more in their death than in their life. Samson, when he died, apparently killed 3,000 Philistines, and it is said of him after his death that he killed more of the Philistines in his death than he had in his lifetime. He accomplished more dying than living. When Jim Elliot and four other American missionaries were contemplating going down to Ecuador to reach the what were then called the Alca Indians, who had killed other missionaries before and had never been evangelized because they were too ferocious and missionaries didn't want to go down there anymore. These five young men just out of college, brilliant, gifted, well-bred, good-looking guys who had a lot of promise. They could have been successful pastors of churches in America if they'd wished to stay, but they just felt God calling them to go down and reach these Indians, knowing that the Indians had never let anyone else survive who had gone down to reach them, and therefore knowing they were putting their life in their hands and possibly going to die. People in America, Christians, said to Jim Elliot, you're a fool to give up the prospects you could have here. To go down and throw away your life for some people who aren't even interested in what you have to say. It's just a foolish move. And most Christians now can quote Jim Elliot because it's become almost legendary, his response. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep in order to gain what he cannot lose. And he went down there with his four friends, and he met the Alca Indians, and he died with them, with his four friends. The five of them were killed by the Alcas almost on their first meeting. So the seed fell into the ground and died, accomplishing apparently nothing. It really seemed like they were fools. They did waste good, young, gifted lives. They just threw them away for these people. But as most of us know the sequel, although some may not know all of it, Jim Elliot's wife and the wives of some of the others actually went back to those Indians and converted the tribe. In fact, the fact that they were still loving these people after they had killed their husbands was the thing that perhaps impressed the Indians the most and perhaps made them the most vulnerable to the message that these women brought them. So Elizabeth Elliot and one of the other women I think it was Marge Rachel Saint. Was it Marge Saint?
Rachel Saint.
Rachel Saint, I'm sorry, yeah. Went down there and they converted these Indians. But there's more. Because the news of these missionaries being martyred down there was reported in the United States in national news. And it created a national outrage in some respects. In fact, there was even talk, I think, of sending the Marines down there to, you know, kill off these Indians because they're murderous, they're murdering our boys, you know. That they were dissuaded from doing. I don't know if that was a serious plan or not. But what was interesting is the news of the death of these five missionaries inspired many other college students to want to go on the mission field. And it's estimated that over 1,000 college students immediately afterward signed up to go on the mission field because of the death of these five men. So here's a case where five seeds fall into the ground and die, seemingly accomplishing nothing, except that the tribe was won and 1,000 more missionaries got on boats and airplanes to go out and reach the lost. Many times, the way God accomplishes things is counterintuitive from our point of view. The way down is sometimes the way up. The way of victory seems to be the way of failure. Nothing seemed more like a failure than Jesus dying on the cross and saying it is finished and giving up his spirit and descending into Sheol. But the Bible says that in doing so, he disarmed principalities and powers and made a show of them openly and triumphed over them in it. And he accomplished what he came to do through that means. So Jesus tells us, of course, the paradox that if you love your life, you seek to save your life, well, you're going to lose it. If you hate your life, give up your life, then you'll find it and, of course, receive, keep it for eternal life. He says in verse 26, if anyone serves me, let him follow me. What's that mean? My disciples, you're my servants, right? I'm your Lord. Well, I'm a seed. I'm going to be buried. I'm going to go into the ground and die. You've got to follow me. If you want to be my servants, you've got to go where I go. You've got to do what I do. So that where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. So, there is a reward in it. If you die, if you imitate Christ, if you deny yourself and take up your cross and follow Jesus, the Father will honor you. And when you think about it, there can be no honors more desirable for a person to obtain than the honor of God himself. Remember, Jesus said to the Pharisees in John chapter 5, how can you believe who receive honor one from another and do not seek the honor that comes from God alone? Jesus said, whoever acknowledges me before men, my Father, he says, I will acknowledge before my Father in heaven. And to receive that honor before the Father and from the Father is apparently the one motivation that Jesus thinks is worth everything. You know, that's what Jesus came to do, to glorify or to honor his Father, not seek his own honor. Apparently to honor God and to have God honor you back is incomparable with any other thing that the human life could seek as a goal. And so even to die, even to hate your life and to die so that you'd have God honoring you is certainly no waste. A person is not a fool to give what he cannot keep in order to gain what he cannot lose. Then Jesus continues in verse 27, and I guess I see now we will not get into chapter 13. Now my soul is troubled, he said, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. So he says, he's starting to be troubled, contemplating his death. He's been talking about his death, and it's a troubling thing. Now Jesus experienced a lot of emotion when he contemplated his death. Later on in the Garden of Gethsemane, he was so struggling with it that he sweat, as it were, great drops of blood. He experienced a great deal of stress about this. And it might seem strange that he was so affected. I mean, you might say, well, who wants to die? Well, not very many people want to die, that's true. And to die by crucifixion is certainly not a pleasant way to die. But Jesus wasn't the only man who died that way. Thousands of Jews died by crucifixion. Josephus reports Thousands of Jews were crucified by the Romans. The Romans crucified whoever they wanted to crucify if they thought they were a troublemaker. Jesus was not the only person who died that horrendous death. And yet, many men facing that death, in all likelihood, faced it with stoic, apathy. There are people who go to their deaths, to the gas chamber, to the electric chair, or to the firing squad, and they're stoic. They're not all weepy. They're not all tense. They're not sweating drops of blood. Was Jesus just more sensitive? Was he just more cowardly? Why did Jesus experience such troubling in his spirit over this? Well, I think we understand that when Jesus died, he endured more than just the physical pain and the physical death. There was something much larger that he was carrying. The Bible says he bore our sins in his own body on the tree in 1 Peter chapter 2. It says in Isaiah 53:6, it says, all we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, but the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. There was a burden that was placed upon him that we can't really understand, but he understood it better. And it was something that, though he was a strong man and a courageous man, he was courageous enough to stand in front of people who had stones in their hands and they were ready to toss them. He says, now listen, what are you doing this for? This doesn't make sense. And he just reasoned with them. He wasn't a wimp in the face of danger, but this crucifixion and what he was going to go through was something that he struggled with in his humanity. More than many men struggle with the prospect of dying. No one likes dying, but there are men who face it with courage and with resolve and with contempt for death. But Jesus is troubled and he says, now how can I pray? What should I pray? Should I say, Father, save me from this hour? That wouldn't make any sense. I can't even pray to be delivered from this because this is the hour that I was sent to come here for. This is the hour I've been talking about. This is the hour that had not yet come so many times previously and now is here. It's for this hour that I have come from heaven. So instead he says, Father, glorify your name. That's what he'll pray. Instead of save me from my troubles, he says, glorify your name. And that's very similar, of course, to what he prayed later in the garden. He said, Father, if it's possible, let this cup pass from me, but not my will, but yours be done. The praying that is like the praying of Jesus is that which surrenders to the will of God and does not obsess over personal relief, personal blessing, personal receiving of anything that's desirable. We can make our requests known to God as Jesus himself did. Father, if it's your will, let this cup pass from me. But having said that, if that isn't your will, then disregard this prayer. Not my will, but your will be done. And so he says it this way in this place. Instead of Father, save me from this hour, he says, Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven saying, I have both glorified it and I will glorify it again. Now this is the third time in the life of Jesus where God spoke with an audible voice from heaven. Once was, of course, at his baptism, when he said, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. There was another time at the Mount of Transfiguration when God said to the three disciples, this is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased, hear him. And now a third time, and apparently a final time, God speaks audibly from heaven and says, I will glorify it again. I have glorified it and I will glorify it again. That is my name. Now, apparently everybody heard the voice of God speak, but different people gave it different interpretations. It says, therefore, the people who stood by and heard it said that it thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Now, some recognize that there was a message in this sound, that there was a voice, there were words. An angel was speaking is what they deduced. Though why they shouldn't assume it was God, I can't say. I mean, he said, Father, glorify your name. And the voice says, I have glorified it and I will glorify it again. Sounds kind of like it's God's voice. After all, it doesn't tell us that it's God's voice, but we can tell. I mean, it's obvious. You can tell from what it says that it is God. So why they would say it's an angel, I don't know. Maybe just if they could not ignore the fact that there was a voice, perhaps they just didn't want to acknowledge that it was God's voice. People are sometimes afraid to hear God's voice. At Mount Sinai, God spoke with the audible voice from the mountaintop, and the people came to Moses and said, "We don't want to hear God's voice anymore. You go talk to God, find out what he says, and you come tell us. But don't let God speak to us anymore." There must be something unnerving about the thought that God is communicating directly that way. But it's interesting, too, that some didn't even recognize it as a voice or didn't acknowledge it. Some said it thundered, which is, it's so obvious that this is the nature of many people who are prejudiced against the supernatural. If somebody who is an atheist tells you that what would get them to believe is if God would appear before them, they're not telling the truth. That wouldn't convince them. If God would speak from heaven, I'd believe it. No, I don't think so. I had a friend in high school who was an unbeliever, and he used to mockingly say, "I'll believe when God speaks from heaven and says, 'I'm God.'" I thought, well, that's happened before, and it didn't make people believe. Some just said it thundered. If God appeared before, you'd say it's a hallucination. It is possible for a person who's determined not to believe in the supernatural to give a natural explanation to everything that is clearly supernatural, and therefore to resist belief. Miracles do not create belief. They may help confirm it, but they do not create it in those who refuse to believe. Then Jesus answered and said, "This voice did not come because of me." In other words, I didn't need this encouragement. I'm in touch with my Father all the time. I knew. He talks to me all the time. "But this is for your sakes it happened." He said, it was for your sake. "Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all peoples to myself." And this he said, signifying by what death he would die. Now, this statement might have been for the benefit of those Greeks. We don't know. He was being rejected by the Jews for the most part, but there were some Greeks showing an interest. But this was a very inopportune for him to be gathering Greek disciples. He's about ready to die. He's going away. This is not really the ideal time for him to start taking on new disciples. And they are Greeks after all, but you know, there will be a time when Greeks are admitted, but it's not at this moment. Remember, Jesus said to the Greek woman, the Syrophoenician woman who had a demon-possessed daughter, and she was seeking his help, he said, "I'm not sent but to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And when he sent out the disciples two by two in Matthew 10, he said, "Go only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Don't go to the Gentile cities." In Jesus' lifetime, he was not reaching out to Gentiles. He would. He had other sheep that he must go to as well, but he was not currently going to them. These Greeks were just a little ahead of schedule. But he says, "I'm going to be lifted up," which means he is signifying being crucified. And he says, "Then I will draw all peoples to me, Jews and Greeks then. Once I've been crucified, once I've accomplished my mission here, it'll no longer be the Jews alone that I'm reaching out to. I'll draw people from all nations to myself." Now, he did say in verse 31, "Now is the judgment of the world." He's not talking about the final judgment, of course, because that wasn't then. But he's saying there is a definitive judgment coming on the world, meaning the world that is ruled by the devil, because he refers to the prince of this world, or the ruler of this world. When the word world is used in the Bible, it's not always used the same way. God loved the world and sent his son. But that just means the population of the earth, the world. But there is also in the Bible this use of the world that we're not supposed to love. "Beloved, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world," John said in 1 John 2:15. There is a world that is not to be loved. In John 15, Jesus said, "If you were of the world would love its own. But because you are not of the world, and I have called you chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you." There is a world, a society, a system that's under the prince of this world. And he's the devil. And so in this world, there is a society that is ruled over by Satan, and that is called the world. Jesus came and started an alternative society called the kingdom of God, ruled over by Christ. So that we often read of these two conflicting humanities, these two conflicting societies. The society whose ruler is the prince of this world, the devil, and the society who follows Christ, the kingdom of God. And it's that world that follows the devil that is now coming under judgment. He says, now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world, or the prince of this world, is going to be cast out. Out of where? Out of power, certainly. But the picture is more graphically given to us in Revelation chapter 12, where we have this, no doubt, symbolic vision of a war in heaven, the dragon and his angels fighting against Michael and his angels. And it says in Revelation 12, beginning at verse 9, it says that, and the dragon, no more place was found for him in heaven, and he was cast out, he and his angels with him. And then a voice in heaven in verse 10 says, now has come salvation and strength in the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of the brethren has been cast out, who accused them before our God day and night. The accuser of the brethren is Satan, and he is cast out. When? Well, Jesus tells us when. He says, now. Now shall the ruler of this world be cast out. At the cross, Satan is cast out. That's why the angels say, now salvation has come. And the power of God and of his Christ have come. The kingdom of God. So, this casting out of Satan took place through the death and resurrection of Christ. And is the definitive victory of Christ over his enemy. Satan was judged and condemned. Satan is no longer heard against us with his accusations. The accuser of the brethren has been cast out. Who can bring anything against any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies, Paul said in Romans 8. There is no accusation that God will hear against us in heaven from Satan. He's been thrown out of court. The prosecutor had his case thrown out. And he has been cast out. He has been judged unworthy and unqualified and incompetent and finished in his role as an accuser of the brethren, as he had done day and night previously in the Old Testament. The death of Jesus pulled out from under Satan all grounds of accusation against the brethren. And so it's as if he's graphically depicted as being tossed out of the courtroom, where he can no longer testify and accuse God's people. The people answered him, verse 34, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? Now, in the immediate context, he had not used the term Son of Man, but he used it a lot. And people apparently knew that he referred to himself as the Son of Man. And when he talked about, if I be lifted up, they say, how can you say the Son of Man is going to be lifted up? We thought the Christ is never going to die. He's going to be around forever. Well, that's yet another notion that they had about the Messiah. There's a lot of different notions that people had about the Messiah. There was not one homogeneous belief among the Jews. These ones believed the Messiah to be an immortal man and would never die. But Jesus is talking about being lifted up and speaking in that way about being crucified, the way that he would die. Jesus said to them, a little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. Now, he ignores their question. They say, who is this Son of Man? He just ignores the question and says, listen, time is running out. I'll choose the topics. You know, I'm not taking questions right now. I have something I want to say. And it is that you have only a little time left to walk in the light until that light is taken from you. It says, he who walks in darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. Paul refers to us as children of light in the book of Ephesians. And also in Philippians, we're called children of light, who shine like lights in the dark world. These things Jesus spoke and departed and was hidden from them. He could only come out in public briefly because there was a price on his head. There were people who were planning to kill him. There was actually word out on the street that if anyone knew where he was, they should report him so he could be arrested. From time to time, he emerged, and he'd make these public pronouncements for a few minutes, and then he'd disappear again and hide. And that was one of his brief appearances. Now, John gives this kind of a summary because he's about ready to transfer the narrative from the story of Jesus' outreach to the world to his private ministry with the disciples in the upper room. John gives much more attention, more chapters, to what went on privately between Jesus and the disciples in the upper room than any of the other Gospels do. Beginning at chapter 13 and going through chapter 14 and 15 and 16, we have four chapters, long ones, devoted to interaction between Jesus and his disciples in the upper room the night before he was arrested. And so, after this point that we've read, he's not really doing public ministry anymore. This is the end of his public ministry. And John is about ready to transition into telling about his private ministry to his disciples in the upper room. And so John then gives, sort of a summary here of Jesus' ministry, of how he was received by some and rejected by some. It says, but although he had done so many signs before them, they did not believe in him, that the word of Isaiah, which the prophet might be fulfilled, which he spoke, Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? That's the first verse of Isaiah 53, a very familiar chapter to Christians because it's the chapter that describes Christ's rejection and crucifixion and so forth. Isaiah 53:1, it begins, Lord, who has believed our report? As if to say, not very many. Are there any you can find, any you can name? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Therefore they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, and this time it's Isaiah chapter 6 he's quoting, Isaiah 6:10, he says, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their hearts, lest they should see with their eyes and understand with their heart, lest they should turn so that I should heal them. It says, these things Isaiah said when he saw his glory, that is Christ's glory, and spoke of him. So John tells us that Isaiah 53 is about Christ, and that chapter 6, where in Isaiah chapter 6, that's where it begins, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord, Yahweh, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. And the seraphim were there, and they were saying, holy, holy, holy is Yahweh, God Almighty. And this is a vision of Yahweh that Isaiah had, but John says that this was John seeing Christ. What he saw there was the glory of Christ, obviously equating Christ with Yahweh. The Yahweh who appeared to Isaiah in chapter 6 was the glory of Christ that he saw then. It's also a point of interest to those who are students of Isaiah, and those who are not may not be the least bit interested in this point, but liberal scholars have been saying for quite a few years now that the man Isaiah did not write the entire book of Isaiah. That the first 39 chapters were written probably by Isaiah, or at least most of them were. But that the last 27 chapters, chapter 40 through 66, must have been written by someone else much later. Why? Well, there's a number of reasons why. One is that the setting seems to be different. The writer of the latter part seems to be writing in the setting of the Babylonian exile, which was 100 years after Isaiah's time. Actually, more than 100 years after Isaiah's time. And another thing is that he mentions Cyrus in the latter part, the Persian who conquered Babylon and let the Jews go back to their homeland. Certainly, they say Isaiah, living in the days of Hezekiah, could not have predicted Cyrus by name, as he does, since Cyrus wasn't even born yet and wouldn't be born for another 150 years. Therefore, they say, the second part of Isaiah must not have been written by the same man. And so they consider the second part of Isaiah was written by some anonymous individual. And since they don't know his name, they just call him Deutero, or second Isaiah, Deutero Isaiah. And sometimes they believe there's even a third author's hand in there, and they call him Trito Isaiah, Deutero and Trito Isaiah. and so forth, all these theories. What I find interesting here is that John quotes from Isaiah 53, verse 1, which is in the second part of Isaiah. And he quotes from Isaiah 6, verse 10, which is in the first part. And he says both of them were Isaiah talking. He said, of the first verse he quotes, Isaiah 53, says that the word of Isaiah the prophet might be fulfilled. And then in verse 39, when he quotes the other part, he says, therefore they could not believe because Isaiah said again. And then after both quotes, he says, these things Isaiah said. So John affirms that passages from the first part and from the second part of Isaiah were in fact written by Isaiah, which just means that if the scholars say it's not so, then they don't respect John's opinion. And that is probably the case. They probably don't. But we do, because he was an apostle of Christ. Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed. Now, we're told that for the most part, though people saw signs and wonders, they didn't believe in him because Isaiah said that they would not. But some did. There was a remnant, and that remnant even existed among some of the rulers. But they didn't believe him deeply, apparently. They didn't want to take a stand for him. Nevertheless, even among the rulers, many believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue. Same problem that the man who was born blind, his parents were afraid to confess Christ because they didn't want to be put out of the synagogue. Didn't want to be excommunicated. The man himself who had been born blind and healed did confess Christ, and he got thrown out of the synagogue. Many were afraid to have that happen to them, for they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God. Therefore, although they were Jewish, they weren't really true Jews. How do we know that? Because in Romans chapter 2, verses 28 and 29, Paul said, he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh, but he's a Jew who is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men, but from God. A true Jew is a person who is inwardly a Jew, who seeks his praise from God, not from men. But these people, rulers of the Jews, they really did believe Jesus was who he said he was, but they didn't have the courage of their convictions to own up because they loved the praise of men more than the praise of God, which is the opposite of what Paul says about true Jews. Then Jesus cried out and said, and this is really the last recorded thing that Jesus said in John to the public before he retired into the upper room and spoke only to his disciples. Sort of one final parting shot. He cried out and said, he who believes in me believes not in me, but in him who sent me. Now this is an example of what I've called a limited negative. Whoever believes in me doesn't believe in me, but believes in him who sent me. It means does not believe only in me, but also in him who sent me. It's a Hebraism often found in the scripture, which takes the form of not A, but B. And it really means not only A, but also B. It's just a manner of speaking, and we see it here. And many other passages, once you discover that that idiom is used, it actually gives new understanding to quite a few important passages in the Bible that have that construction, not this, but that. When you realize that it really means not only this, but also that. Like when Jesus said, do not labor for the food that perishes, but labor for the food that endures to eternal life. He means, of course, don't only labor for the food that perishes, also labor for the food that endures to eternal life. And there's many cases of that, as here. But the point he's making is, if you believe in me, it's not just me you're believing in, you're believing in God. And he who sees me sees him who sent me. This he also told his disciples in the upper room in John 14:9, where he says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. He says the same thing here to the public. He who sees me sees him who sent me. I have come as a light into the world, that whoever believes in me should not abide in darkness. And if anyone hears my words and does not believe, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. That is, I don't judge him right now. The time will come when I will judge, because the Father has committed all judgment to the Son, because he's the Son of Man. Jesus is going to ultimately be the judge on the throne. That's what he said in Matthew 25:31. When the Son of Man shall come in his glory, with all his holy angels with him, then he'll sit on the throne of his glory, and he'll call all the nations before him, and he'll separate them like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats, and he'll send off the goats in one place and the sheep somewhere else. He's the judge. He, the Son of Man, will sit on the throne of his glory and do this judging, but not at his first coming. That's not what he's there for, he says. I'm not judging him. If anyone doesn't hear my words, does not believe, then I don't judge him. For I did not come to judge the world, not this time, but to save the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words has that which judges him. The word that I have spoken will judge him in the last day. Now, he's mentioned the last day four times earlier in John chapter 6. In John 6, 39, and in John 6, 40. And in John 6, 44, and in John 6, 54. In all cases, he was talking about his own people. And he said four times, I will raise them up in the last day. So the resurrection of the godly takes place in the last day. But now he says in chapter 12 and verse 48 that the lost ones, those who reject him, who will be judged, says the word that I've spoken will judge him in the last day. So it is this same day, the righteous will be raised and raptured, and the judgment of the world will take place on that same day. It's the last day. Now notice he said, the word that I have spoken will judge him. People will be judged by comparison of their actions and their beliefs to what Jesus has said. That's going to be the standard. So it would do well to pay heed to what Jesus said. I say that because there are many people who spend a lot more time paying heed to, say, what they find in the epistles, which, by the way, are authoritative also. But many people avoid the teachings of Jesus because they don't seem, they say, well, that's for a different dispensation or something. Not for our time, not for us. But Jesus said, when you judge, you'll be judged by his words, so you might as well pay attention to them. For I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command that I should say, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Therefore, whatever I speak, just as the Father has told me, so I speak. And then we pass from his public ministry entirely to a section, not quite as long, but quite nearly as long, that makes up the latter part of, actually, the last few days of his life and his resurrection. It's amazing what a large portion of the Gospel of John is given to those last few days, from chapter 13 to chapter 21, whereas only 12 chapters have been given to the whole 3 years prior. But the Gospels are that way. They do, all of them, give a disproportionately large bulk of their chapters to the last, at least the last week, and the crucifixion and resurrection. It's obvious that although everything Jesus did and said were significant, the Gospel writers wanted to underscore particularly his death and his resurrection, and that's why they gave so much more space to that than to anything else comparable in the Gospels. So the next time we will get into chapter 13. And the upper room discourse, as it is called.